your favorite cartoon characters will help you understand how drugs and alcohol can ruin your life. So watch the program. Talk about it with your family.
Welcome back to Special Presentation with Mike and Ethan, or...
Alf will not be seen tonight.
Hey, let's take a trip back to the 80s, but not the part of the 80s where it was actually the 80s everyone thinks about, the part of the 80s where it's still the 70s.
Yeah, back when, well, I guess when there was still bell bottoms, no, that's 60s, and tie-dye... No,
that's
wait.
Still the 60s, yeah.
Okay.
Where it was still the disco era.
Oh, that's right. Because disco really was only around for, what, 78 and 79?
Yeah. I mean, it was 78, 79, 80, 81, really. And then it kind of merged with Nuevo Huevo and became techno. It never really went away. But...
Well, that's because disco is extremely good. It fucking slaps. I love disco.
I mean, I love disco music. What I thought I hated about disco turned out to be all of the stuff that had kind of been poison pilled to disco to make it to ruin it, like the cocaine culture.
Yeah. And of course, you know, so much of disco was over the years has been maligned because it was a largely, you know, black and gay subculture. And white guys didn't like that, so they started the whole disco sucks movement that most people, that's all they remember. So it's very weird, because even today you still meet people who are convinced disco is bad, but have never listened to disco. Anyway.
It didn't help that during our childhoods, there was always that ad for the disco classics collection with the guy going, "I love disco, and I hear it's making a comeback."
Oh, really?
Yeah,
any day now.
And he's this giant fucking nerd like Dennis the Menace's dad. And... it was another poison pill to keep disco from rising again.
But speaking of Dennis the Menace's dad,
he's here.
In fact, he's one of the many characters that appear in...
The Fantastic Funnies. I almost call it the Fabulous... Oh, wait, this is the Fabulous Funnies, isn't it?
No, isn't it the Fantastic Funnies?
God, one I don't second. Know, because these are two different shows. There's the Fab... I think the Fabulous Funnies was an animated Saturday morning the collection of cartoons.
Yeah, a Lou Scheimer thing, I think.
Yeah, the Lou Scheimer thing, yeah. A number of things from this come from it. But the Fantastic Funnies is a special, and... When we talk about specials, this is the kind we almost never talk about, where it's... Oh, boy.
Is this an extravaganza? What is this?
You might say that. If there were more than one Loni Anderson, it would be an extravaganza.
But... Yeah.
This... Now, when your grandma, or maybe your mom, if you're as old as us... told you that TV rots your brain, this is what she was talking about. This is TV at its most vapid.
What? I mean, okay, so here's the thing is, what is this about? What is the point of this special?
Is it's like an all-star tribute to the comics?
Okay, that's so strange, because it feels like, well, you know, we were watching it. It's a CBS special from 1980. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. So literally the start of the 80s.
Yes.
And it basically just introduces you very briefly to a bunch of popular newspaper comics. And it feels like they were like, hey, people aren't aware that there are comics in the newspaper. We need to raise awareness of this, which is very strange. Considering this was at the height of the monoculture, so literally everyone in America would be familiar with these things.
And it doesn't... And our hostess does not really does not really do the comics any favors when she says, if you didn't need more proof that the Funnies are more popular than ever, we've got 7 movies based on comic strips coming out just this year. I was like, well, that just reinforces the importance of the movies over comic strips.
Yeah, true. There are a few things, speaking of, because a few of the clips appear to come from these comic movies.
Yes, and one of them definitely does.
Right. And there are also a few bits that seem to be clips from other comic-related properties, like the Annie bit, which we'll talk about. So I assume there were just a lot of things that are like, we need to promote these random things that are happening that are related to comics.
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe this is like an infomercial from United Feature Syndicate and et al. So
we're like, we didn't really reach the kids with The Man Who Hated Laughter, so we're going to try a different tactic this time.
Yeah, this is just, what, like 7 years after Popeye Meets the Man Who Hated Laughter, and you can definitely tell that it's still, that the comics are still very different from the ones that we grew up with, because there's a large focus on Prince Valiant.
God, I'm sorry, but like, I do not believe for a second that even people of the 70s were actually reading Prince Valiant.
Oh boy, I can't wait to read Prince Valiant, says the skydiver.
Yeah. And the pirate, the air pirate? Whatever that guy was. We'll get it. This will make sense later in the episode, folks.
Yeah. Yeah, we like to put fourth dimensional jokes in that make more sense once you've read it, once you've listened and are listening again. So
that's right. It's a little literary technique you might have heard of called foreshadowing.
So, and it all starts out with a random blonde woman who apparently used to be a celebrity of some kind.
Oh, wait, that wasn't Loni Anderson?
No, it was Loni Anderson. I just don't know who Loni Anderson is outside of this. I've never watched WKRP. That was apparently what she was in.
Oh, she was on that show. That's right. I completely forgot that she was on WKRP in Cincinnati. Because for some reason, I know Loni Anderson was kind of like a bombshell-type sex symbol of the 70s.
Yeah.
But for some reason, I always think she was married to Donald Trump at some point.
Then she'd be dead.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, true. I think I'm mixing her up with like Marla Maples or something. I don't really know. But
Zadora.
She's, yeah. Was, oh my God. She does actually have a Pia Zadora look, to be true, honest. But no,
yeah,
Loni Anderson.
Germar, but
no, a role for the ages. But Loni Anderson was on WRKP in Cincinnati, which was a sitcom. I remember watching it as a kid about a radio station. I don't remember anything. I remember thinking it was very funny, but I was also 8, so I don't, and I couldn't tell you anything else about it other than that.
I've never seen an episode, but they once showed us a clip from it in science class.
Was it science related?
Yes, it was about, it was this, one of the characters from WKRP, and he was dealing with this kid, this black kid who was having trouble with school, and he was kind of being courted by gangs. And so he says to him, and he lays out this idea like, well, you know how the gangs are. You've got the pro raiders, and they huddle together, and they have the neutral boys who are always protecting them. And then they have their enemies. They call themselves the elected ones who walk in a circle around them. And he teaches him the structure of an atom by using gang members as particles.
I mean, I guess that's clever, but I suspect that's not how a gang operates in real life. But
no.
Anyway,
I hate
so,
being
yeah.
part of the elected ones marching in a circle all day.
Yeah,
I gotta get jumped out.
It was a show. I mean, it did exist, and it does come into play later in this episode as well, or in this special that we're about to watch.
Yes.
So Loni Anderson is telling us, so she appears, and she tells us that they're going to do a tribute to the comics, and that the Funnies are funny and a thing that we should be aware of.
Yes. And then does it cut to the opening song then?
Yeah, no. Yes, it does, because there's a song, and this is terrible. I hate this song. Because
yes, a song that I was like, the gum commercial choir, ladies and gentlemen.
What I love is the absolute just can do the absolute like did not give a shittiness of it because
The thieves, yeah, the lyrics are literally, "Come join us now, fantastic funnies are wow."
from what is it like
From Beetle Bailey to Charlie Brown, from Dagwood Bubstead to Hagar's Town.
Really,
Yeah,
Hager's Town.
they really focus on his town, don't they?
Yeah, it's a very big element of the strip. I mean,
Yes.
I guess Hager lives in a town. He's a Viking, so he really mostly lives aboard his ship,
Yeah, it
but
should have been Hagar's boat, but I guess
yeah,
there wasn't
but I guess
anything
they
that
couldn't
rhymed
rhyme
with
it. Yeah, but
Brown.
then they continue on and they say, I don't know, like
From Orphan Annie to Alley Oop, from Barney Google to Mama's Soup, and
now, okay, Mom, I have read Mama, and I can tell you with complete authority, Mama's Soup plays less of a role than a Hager's Town.
yes,
Mama,
but.
does she ever make soup?
What, but did you see what happens over that line?
No, what
A woman
happens?
is reading the funnies as she feeds her baby from a bottle, and it zooms right in on the milk. And I'm like, oh God, is that what Mama's soup is? That sounds like some sort of
Oh.
awful, sounds like some sort of lactation thing. Oh, I want to taste your sweet mama soup.
Oh, I don't like that at all. That just makes me think that, like, it makes me think of that, like that awful, something weird is going on, like that book about the mom who breaks into her grown kid's house to like lullaby sing them, you know?
Oh, you mean Love You Forever? Yeah.
Yeah, it sounds like something like that sort of shit.
You call
Except
it
that she's
Something Weird is Going On?
The only difference is
Because.
that she's like breastfeeding Francis during this, so it's like, oh no,
Oh.
no good, no good.
Oh, my
But
other
yeah.
favorite part is when it zooms out, it cuts to a tiger reading the comics over a girl's shoulder. And I was
Yeah,
like,
you
hey,
know.
it's Susie and Hobbs.
Oh, a comic that had not yet actually premiered by this point, I
No.
believe. Yeah, so then I guess Loni Anderson is going to take us into the world of the comics with help from Bill Melendez.
Yes. This is our fifth Bill Melendez thing in a row. We really need to do something else.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's interesting because I mean Bill Melendez, he does, I mean, it's a fairly good job of of melding all these different comic styles. The thing
Some
that's
of them. Some of them are standout bad, but a lot of them are very good.
that's true. So Loni Anderson does that thing where she's dressed like a hillbilly girl,
Yes.
and she's all like, I'm gonna go into animation with the power of Bill Melendez, and I wanted to be like Olive Oil, but he said I should be Daisy May. And both comics that were very relevant in 1980, I'm sure.
Just thinking of Bill Melendez, like, yeah, olive oil. No, I'm gonna give you tits, lady.
Yeah. Well, yeah. And then he's like, I'm also gonna make your face like 5 feet wide. I'm
Yeah,
gonna
her face is huge and covered in lines. She looks like she's 80. It's hideous.
Yeah. Bill Melendez is like so hot. Yeah.
Bill
He's in he's
Melendez,
like
great animator, not the best caricaturist.
No. But he but she goes into the world of the comics and all the cartoon characters are there in like a jury box or
Yeah,
something.
it's like festival seating.
Yeah, and they're all just like they all just kind of like welcome her into the world of the funnies. And
Yeah, as if all their mouths were on a single string. Hi, Lonnie.
yeah, and she introduces us to them. And it is interesting because I think first she says, all right, here's the comics that have been around for like 100 years. And it's all the ones that none of our listeners will be familiar with because it includes Alley Oop,
Alley-oop.
Blondie, who else is in there?
Barney Google. Boy, do they focus on Barney Google a lot in this one.
Okay,
They
so
don't even
yes.
acknowledge Snuffy Smith.
No, they do not. And okay, so I know this is getting slightly ahead because there is a whole bit with Barney Google, but should we wait
Yeah,
till we
let's
get to that
wait.
bit? Okay, let's power through the rest of these introductions. So
Yes.
they have all the old ones, and then they get into the ones that have been around like 50 years. And then 20 years, and they kind of whittle down,
And then dogs.
and dogs, yes, and then that fresh-faced newcomer Garfield, who just premiered this year.
Yeah. Garfield the cat.
Yeah. He is the first, I believe Jim Davis did say, well, there were a lot about dogs and there was no cat comic, so I decided I'd make a cat comic. I like how I'm just decided, like, he's Charles Bronson. That's the Jim Davis voice, apparently. It
blows my mind to realize that Heathcliff isn't even that much older than Garfield. It's only like 5 years older.
God, I always got the impression Heathcliff was one of those ancient 1920s comics that they just kept updating, you know?
No. It first started in 1973, and then Garfield came in 1978.
Wow. Speaking of the 70s, that one of these 70s comics that they mentioned actually kind of surprised me, and that is Drabble.
Yeah, and you see Drabble for 2 seconds, and then never again.
Yeah, because Drabble is one of those guys, those comics that was not well drawn in this, I think, that you mentioned.
Yeah. I wrote in my notes that Drabble is so hideous, it makes me wonder if Bill Melendez had a grudge against the creator.
Yeah, I thought it was weird, because I always assumed Drabble was probably a late 80s comic. I didn't know it was around at that point. Mm. And honestly, it's one of those comics that, like, I don't think anyone has... Drabble is a comic that you think about as you are reading Drabble and then immediately forget as soon as you finish. So it's very strange to see it acknowledged in this. But,
well, I mean, it's funny that it's named after, like, a story that's 100 words or less. So.
True. I believe Drabble is the surname of the main character family. Ethan, do you know anything about Drabble?
You're right. Yeah. There's a mom, a dad, a teenage or 20 something son, and a younger son. And the dad is fat and plays golf. The elder son is kind of dumb. The mom and younger son have no personality. And much like with The Simpsons and later South Park, as it goes on, the cartoonist has focused a lot less on the teenage son and a lot more on the aging dad.
So, okay.
And yeah. That is all you need to know about Drabble. Oh, the one other thing about Drabble. Remember how, you know, basically the unaired pilot to Special Presentation was one time when Mike and I were making videos and we just got really distracted talking about the comics.
That's right.
Yes. And we were talking about the great comic Switcheroo, and the Drabble one might actually be one of the funniest ones, because it's incredibly badly drawn, and it has the dad and the teenage son having a conversation where they're like, hey, the comics all look weird today. Yeah, the cartoonists thought they'd have some fun and switch cartoons today. Boy, what would happen if your comic was so lame that nobody wanted to switch with you? Well, you'd probably just have to draw with your left hand.
Oh, that's so sad. Yeah. But it's actually really funny.
It is. Probably the funniest Drabble ever.
Wow. Good for you, Mr. Drabble. The cartoon's so forgettable, I cannot be bothered to look up the cartoonist's name. This special is probably the most attention Drabble has received ever. The 2 seconds that Mr. Drabble is on screen for.
Yes. I've got a list. We've got in this one shot where it pans over all the characters in the festival seating, you see Nancy, you see Dick Tracy, you see Al-Yoop, you see Arthur Strim, but they credit him as Miss Peach.
What? Oh, that's right. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. You see Drabble, I guess it's the kid Drabble. You see Fred, and you see Fred Bassett. And this is their only shot.
Huh. Yeah, they never come up again at all, do they?
Yeah. So some of these characters, their only line in animation ever is, "Hi, Lonnie."
Wow. Thanks. Really made. Yeah.
Depressing.
Yeah, but wouldn't it be more depressing if we had to review a Drabble special for this?
Oh, well, hang on to that in case we ever have to make up our own specials again when we
There
run
you
low.
Go.
The Drabble Mother's Day.
But anyway, so the comics all they're all like, so she introduces them all, and then Lonnie's like, I gotta get back to the real world, and they're like, but Lonnie, sorry, this is Hager the Horrible talking. He yes. says, Lonnie, what? We gotta sing you a song.
Yeah, that is the worst Hagar voice ever.
But Lonnie, we have prepared a song for you.
That bad voices is going to be a recurring theme in this special.
Yeah, Hagar and multiple other characters sound like if you were 4 years old and you asked your mom to read the comics to you to go to sleep.
Yeah, like the, yeah, exactly.
That's the voice your mom would do for Hagar.
Yeah, it is. It's weird. I mean, I really don't know what voice Hagar would have because we have not listened. We haven't done the Hagar special for this show yet.
No, there is a Hagar special, right?
Yeah, there is. But I would expect Hagar would sound kind of, I don't know, a little more Fred Flintstone-y, you know?
I can't believe he doesn't at least have a bit of a Scandinavian accent.
Oh, you're right. He totally should. What are they trying to pull here? He should be like, Lonnie, we must sing you a song.
Lonnie.
There you go. That's better, actually. So Lonnie's like, I really gotta go. And Hager's like,
oh no, dude, please don't go to the trouble. No, yeah. No.
Hager's like, no,
I'm gonna be standing here going la 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 la.
So they do sing a song. I do not remember the song.
What does it go? We're in the funny business. Da 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 fun. But during the song, my favorite moment is when
we're just a bunch of crazy guys and dolls.
My favorite moment is when, the moment where you see Alley-Oop and Prince Valiant together, and Alley-Oop is just dancing and grooving away, and Prince Valiant is standing stock still. Like,
he is drawn like in the comic, though. So you want to try and animate that shit?
Yeah.
Bill Melendez was like, fuck this.
He's drawn like a Carrie. He's animated like a Terry Gilliam
cartoon. He really is. Oh my god.
Also, you get some of that in the long shots where they're all talking together. Some of their mouths are like kind of bleeding off of their faces.
Bill Melendez was like, this was not obviously. You know, he wasn't putting the same care into this that he was putting into, like, Molly and the Skywalkers.
No, I think
this is a paycheck for him. So, yes. You know, I mean, hey, gotta eat. So what are you going to do?
The more we build on this character of Bill Melendez, the miserable put upon animator who puts his aggression into everything he's contracted to draw.
This is our headcanon for Bill Melendez. The Bill Melendez permanent midnight alternate universe. Oh my god!
So bad, poor Bill Melendez. He didn't deserve this from us.
Yeah. I think it's sad that we're probably giving more attention to Bill Melendez than anyone in like 20 years. But because legitimately, he's a good animator. His work
really
is good, and we're just talking smack about him. But anyway,
it's because we love you.
Yes,
we love you, Bill. Rest in peace.
Yeah, and actually, I'll say this: there's some bits in this special that do stand out as better animated.
Oh yes, absolutely. The Broomhilda sequence.
Yes. Oh, speaking of Broomhilda, she makes her first speaking appearance in this bit because Loni needs to get back to the real world, and she's like, "Oh, how do I get back?" And Broomhilda is like, with the voice of June Foray, of course.
Yes.
Jerry, I'll do it. You know. And she's
watching this. My co-author from Joy Traveler is like, who's this witch? I want to be her.
Oh my god. How? She's never seen Broomhilda?
Apparently not, but, well, maybe she was just too well drawn, because I think we watched the Fabulous Funnies with Broomhilda before, but...
Oh! We got a new episode on that, especially the episode where she learns how to... She deals with her alcohol problem. Which is an actual episode of that TV series.
Which was, it was a Saturday morning series, right?
Yeah, I think that was a thing. But first things first, Broomhilda does a spell, and I think she says something like, I'm no rube. Now you're on the tube. Hold on to your tummy. It's time for those fantastic funnies. And then Loni is back in the real world. And she's like, oh, wow, that was, what a trip. Well, guys, stay in your dressing rooms. And from off stage, all the fabulous funnies say, okay, Loni.
Okay, Loni.
And then, oh gosh, what happens then in the next
And then
sequence?
She just leans on a ladder and sings for 3 minutes.
Oh, that's right, because she's like, you know, a lot of the Fantastic Funnies have been adapted to stage and screen and have songs like the Little Orphan Annie song, in which she sings. And
the one that I've only ever heard in A Christmas Story.
Yeah. Oh, you're right, actually. I just realized that is the same song, isn't it?
Yep.
And then she also mentions, oh, and the song that I really love, and everybody, of course, remembers, Barney Google, with them googly eyes.
Yes.
Now, to be fair, this song is incredibly catchy. Because, I mean, it was like, that's right. It's like, Barney Google, with them googly eyes. Barney Google, he lost everything in the divorce. Now he's now he's got to fuck his horse. I don't know. It's, you know, it's a catchy song.
It's hard to have sex with your horse when it's got a guitar inside of it. Call back.
No, the thing is, though, so have we discussed Barney Google on this show before?
He was an important, well, no, Barney Google himself was not part of Popeye Meets the Man Who Hated Laughter, but his horse was.
And, that's right, Sparkplug.
Yeah, Sparkplug, who is best, I think, is best known now for being the reason that Charles Schulz had the nickname Sparky all his life, because he was a big fan of Barney Google. And,
interesting.
Yeah.
Now, so for listeners who have not yet listened to that particular episode,
yes,
and you should, because it's a good one.
You're proud of it, yes.
That is a good one. Let's explain Barney Google. Yes. So Barney Google was a comic strip that began in 1919.
Yes.
And Barney Google was like a little dude with like a top hat. I think he was kind of a trickster sort of character. You know, he always had some scheme that he was doing.
Yeah, that kind of thing.
Yeah,
he's a gambler, a troublemaker, but on the kind of, I don't think he was like he like ended up in jail like Ignatz or anything like that. But
yeah. I believe he was probably one of those guys. He's like, oh, I'm gonna pull some scheme. Yeah, make a lot of money. I don't know. I honestly know the amount that I actually know about Barney Google is from this song that Loni Anderson sings. And the reason for that is because in 1934, Barney Google, there was a extended plot arc where he visited Hoot and Holler in North Carolina and met a little moonshiner named Snuffy Smith, whom some of our listeners may have heard of.
Yes.
Now, Snuffy Smith became so popular that gradually Barney Google was edged out of his own comic strip, just like Popeye edged all the assembled cast of Thimble Theater out. And Barney Google disappeared from his own comic sometime in the mid-1950s, which means that by the time this special was made, Barney Google had not appeared in his own comic for 30 years. And who is this made for?
I'm just imagining someone like Mr. Burns being like, oh, I want to see Barney Google in his googly eyes.
Seriously. It's like I've got to catch the next aerogyro from Siam because I must see that delightful Barney Google. It really is a Mr. Burns punchline.
Yeah.
But it is so strange because to even have remembered that Barney Google was in that strip, you would have to be at least 40 years old when this special aired. And
well, we're
even
both
then
40 and we watched it.
Well, I meant like, you know, in 1980, you'd have to be at least 40. Cause I assume if you were younger than 10, when Barney Google disappeared, you wouldn't have really remembered him.
Yeah.
You know, so
maybe
to
this
really
was a soft relaunch of Barney Google.
Well, wait a minute. Was there a Barney Google that movie that year? Cause
No, they didn't mention. No, I wrote down the movies they had. No, that was not one of them.
Oh, okay. So yeah, Barney, they really, it's weird because they play him up, but maybe that was a thing where like they figured, okay, people who are like 40, 50 now may legitimately remember Barney Google, and they don't cotton with this millennial Snuffy Smith. So I don't know. It's very odd because I grew up with Snuffy Smith. Basically, just it was Snuffy Smith, and then in very small letters above it, Barney Google and. So I remember as a child just being like, who the hell is Barney Google? What is he doing in this? Who is he? He's never appeared in the strip.
I didn't think it didn't make any sense. I just thought it was funny to read the title that way. Barney Google
and Snuffy Smith.
Actually, that is pretty funny. I always thought maybe it was some sort of inside joke. It wasn't until like way later I realized, oh, the weird genesis of that strip. Speaking of, interesting thing, Ethan, I don't know how much you know about the history of this particular comic, but I learned an interesting tidbit on Wikipedia about it.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So apparently, Snuffy Smith was in a lodge similar to, you know, the Flintstones with their water buffalo, water buffalo. Right.
That used to be a much bigger thing than it is now.
Yeah, exactly. Now, according to Wikipedia, the Snuffy Smith was in the Varmint's Lodge, and he held the post of Royal Doodlebug, and the strip heavily employed the catchphrase, "What did the Doodlebug say?" An homage to "What did the Wogglebug say?" from queer visitors from the marvelous land of Oz.
Wow. Now, I mean, that is damning as far as how old you would have to be to remember this.
That's right. You would either have to be like 200 years old or have read that wonderful book, Misunderstanding Comics, which also mentions it. Or alternatively, have watched the Hungry Reader video that actually explains it.
Barney Woggle.
Yeah. But yeah, I thought you might find that interesting.
Yes. Also, Barney Google has in fact been making more recent appearances in the Snuffy Smith comic strip. He appeared briefly in 2010. And Snuffy Smith was like, "Barney Google, I haven't seen you in a long time. What you been up to?" "Well, I invested in a tech company and things have turned up for me."
What a weird thing. I'm sorry. It's just weird to think that like they're still drawn like they're like 1910, but they're like, "Yeah, yes, I've invested in tech."
Yeah.
It is I, Barney Google, tech bro.
Yeah. Well, at least his name wasn't Barney Altavista. That would have been
Oh my God. I just got the joke. Oh my
God. I kind of edged you toward it there.
Okay. That's actually pretty clever. I'll give him that. Wow.
And you know, Google wanted to be called Google as in the number followed by 100 zeros.
Right.
But they figured out that they couldn't get that that was already taken for a .com, and two, they realized that everyone would misspell it anyway, so they just went with the Barney Google spelling.
Yeah, all right. Well, I mean, you know, fair, makes sense. Mm-hmm. Seems to have turned out well for them.
Yeah, I think they're doing well. But...
yeah, I've heard of them. but anyway, so we got these three songs apparently from different comics, and then. Loni Anderson is all like, "Or listen to Annie, that hit musical, and here's some girl and a bald guy, I guess the original Broadway performers performing a song from Annie."
Yes, the song "I Don't Need Anything But You," featuring a girl who they didn't bother to put Annie's hairstyle on, or, well, I guess I shouldn't expect them to like put clear contacts on it to give her empty eyes like Annie, but and then they're singing this song, and all the time I'm just looking at Daddy Warbucks thinking he looks like he wants to steal 40 cakes.
Right? I on a repeat viewing of this, I think they mentioned that the actor's name is King Curtis.
Curtis?
which is like kind of blew my mind because it just makes me think of King Curtis from Wife Swap.
Well, I was just thinking, King Curtis, what, could you not get Cowboy of Cartoons?
Ah, that's funny because when I was playing this earlier, my wife was all like, isn't that a guy on Pee-wee's Playhouse?
King Curtis.
And I was like, I think you're mixing up Cowboy Curtis with the King of Cartoons.
Yeah. And after that part, or maybe before, we get a couple of clips from old TV shows based on comic strips. Did you know there was a Blondie sitcom?
I did not know that. Yeah. I did know that there was a Dennis the Menace sitcom, but...
Oh, yeah, that ran on Nickelodeon all the time.
Yeah, but Blondie has been... I mean, Blondie's been around for a long time and has been in every... I guess there were Blondie movies, apparently, so...
There were lots of Blondie movies. There were, like, 15 of them.
Man, it's so strange, and they've completely gone down the memory hole, even though apparently Blondie was the hottest thing since Blondie, I guess. I don't know. But
yeah, so it's like, were they leading up to something? Was there something like a Avengers Infinity War for Blondie?
The Crisis on Infinite Blondies. Oh my god. I think most of them were just like, Blondie, you know, Blondie goes to college, Blondie stubs her toe, Blondie, you know, stuff like that. So
I want to see Blondie stubs her toe.
It's like the great train robbery.
Tossing a Blondie in a blanket.
Yeah.
And then she shows the 7 movies that are coming out in 1980, and some of them I had no idea even existed.
So what were the 7 movies?
Okay, I wrote them down. Popeye. Seen it. Love it. That should be something that we do.
Is that the Robin Williams Popeye?
Yes, yes.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Okay. And then an alley-oop movie? Have you ever heard of this?
No. But it blows my mind that they made... First of all, they made an alley-oop movie. Secondly, they made it in 1980. And 1980. Third, was it theatrically released?
Good question. I don't know. They were all supposed to be theatrically released.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. Was it animated? I don't remember if that was an animated movie.
It doesn't say. Not here, at least. Weird. I've never heard of it. So, and similarly, Blondie. Did you know there was a Blondie movie in 1980?
No. Now, was that animated?
Again, I never heard of this one.
Well, we're going to have to check out. We will have to follow Loni Anderson's recommendation and watch the 1980 Blondie movie.
Yeah, that's the thing about this special, is that it's kind of turned into a to-do list for us.
We're going to have to listen and rate some Blondie albums, because clearly those are also based on the same character, right?
Wow, wouldn't it be weird if... That should be like an actual strip where Blondie is just like, you know, I'm not feeling well. I need to go to the doctor. So they take her to the doctor and he's like, yep, here's your problem. Heart of glass.
It's like Blondie meets the man from Mars. Oh, man. So what are the other movies that Loni recommends?
Well, the next one is Pogo. And that is on our to-do list. We were going to do that one with Lindsay when we get a chance.
Oh, yes, that's right. Now, I think they actually show clips from Pogo later on.
Yeah, they show clips from Pogo, and it's like a special sneak preview. And it has, I think, Jonathan Winters, maybe?
I thought that voice was familiar. Yeah, I think it was. It's claymation, too, which is interesting.
Yes, it is. Not Will Vinton's claymation, but yeah, stop motion clay, that kind of thing.
Right. Yeah. So that's what, four movies? Oh, sorry.
That was 4, yes. The 5th one is Flash Gordon, and I've seen that one.
That movie slaps.
Yeah. Yep, I've seen it. I don't know if I thought it slapped, but... Well, it's a funny thing that happened, was that a few decade or so ago, I realized that I didn't know anything about Flash Gordon, so me and Steph and my then-girlfriend, we went to Hollywood Video and rented everything Flash Gordon-related, which included this movie, the Flash Gordon cartoon from 1990, and the movie Flesh Gordon. And we came to the conclusion that we didn't like Flash Gordon.
Now, wait a second. Several questions arise. First, you didn't get any Defenders of the Earth?
It wasn't available. Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry.
Fair. Now, secondly, I must ask. So you randomly you got a wild hair and decided I really need to know about Flash Gordon.
I can't defend myself. This is just how I am.
All right. Okay. I mean, why not? There's certainly worse things to become curious about. How was Flash Gordon? I've never seen it.
Flash Gordon is, well, the thing about Flash Gordon is that its special effects are way the hell too good for the actual production. They're really impressive, and the movie itself is really kind of dumb.
But would it be worth watching Flash Gordon for this podcast?
Sure. Let's do it.
Well, I'm gonna say,
let's do us a Flash Gordon.
If you're too, like, if it was too bad, we could always try Flash Gordon 2, Attack of the Cosmic Cheerleaders.
Well, I'll just tell you, I have one favorite part of Flash Gordon, and it's my ass.
That's a little teaser for the viewers, sorry, listeners, yes, for when we do the Flash Gordon episode.
Yes, again, the thing where you look forward to thing.
What, that's right.
What do you call that? Chekhov's gun? No, wait.
There you go. Yeah, that's right.
Something like that. Foreshadowing. Thank you.
Foreshadowing. All right. So was
or
that?
In
that was
Flash Gordon's case. Foreskin shadowing.
Ooh. So that was six movies or seven?
That was five.
That was five.
The next one is Annie, which definitely exists.
Yeah. Oh, that's right.
That's probably the best known one.
Yes. I there was a movie Annie. I remember that.
Yes. And I thought the movie Annie was a giant hit, and then I looked up its like box offices and found it was made for on a $57 million budget. It was made on a $50 million budget, and it made $57 million. So I guess it was kind of a hit. It didn't lose money.
Wow, that's funny, because I always assumed there's a big hit too, as much as you hear about it.
Yeah, I guess it's more just the musical itself, the Broadway musical, that was a big hit.
Yeah,
and it got. But by the time we were conscious of Broadway, it had been completely overshadowed by Cats.
Yeah. All right. So that's six. What's number seven?
Bon Voyage, Charlie Brown, and Don't Come Back.
Oh, which I have heard of and seen.
Yes, I don't remember seeing it, but I'm pretty sure I've seen like clips of it, like the French bread bit. That's the one.
Oh, right. Classic. Classic Snoopy.
Whether this was before or after the Annie song, which kind of goes on for a while.
It really does. It's interesting that, like, even though Annie the movie was coming out this year and you think they were trying to promote it, they show clips from Annie the musical, or not even clips. It appears to be just the singers from the musical just dancing around San Francisco and singing.
Yeah, well, it's actually the movie didn't come out for two more years.
Oh, okay. So I guess
delayed,
never mind.
Yeah.
Huh. Well, that's a thing. But yeah, it goes on for a while, and I guess it was delayed because it wasn't very good. Nobody liked it.
Well, what about that other Annie, the one that just came out a few years ago?
Oh, the black Annie?
Yeah,
wait, was
where
she black?
Of Daddy Warbucks, he's Daddy Stacks.
The one where a bunch of SJWs got hold of it and put minorities in it?
They ruined all my favorite things about Annie, like, hang on, let me Google Annie.
It's like, well, you know, some SJW put pupils in all their eyes. I don't like this. I did not see that one, so I can't comment on it. Yeah. We should watch it for this show. In fact, we should watch both Annies and compare them.
Yeah,
and see
yeah.
which is a superior Annie. I vaguely remember the 1981. I have seen it, but it did not make a very big impression. So
no, yeah. I've never seen that one either.
Yeah.
But after this, we have the interview with Charles Schulz.
Yeah. Now this is okay. So first of all, this is sort of getting into the real meat of the special, which
Yes.
is where Loni Anderson will introduce a cartoonist. The cartoonist will tell an anecdote, and then we see a short animated clip of their cartoon. And Loni Anderson is always dressed somehow thematically to the cartoon. So in
Yeah,
this
she's
one,
wearing, yeah.
she's got a Charlie Brown shirt on, and I think she's got like pigtails to indicate that like she's, you know,
A
young.
kid, I
Yeah,
guess. Yeah,
yeah.
I want to say, from the first few seconds, I recognize that this special was a very particular kind of horny. The 70,
Yes.
70s prime time horny, where it's
Yes.
all just a big excuse to ogle Lonnie.
Yep. It's kind of that sort of 70s programming where it's like you expect her to kind of pop out of a cornfield and tell a joke. You know, but like she's it, yeah, she wears a succession of very tight shirts throughout this special. And it's kind of weird that she it's I don't know. I mean, it is not like necessarily off-putting that it's a very tight Charlie Brown shirt, but it is a little odd. You know, it's I look at it, I'm like, I really don't know what to think that I can see nipples through a Charlie Brown shirt.
I'm
But
just glad she's not wearing a bald cap.
oh God. Oh, well, you know, she couldn't even commit to the bit. But anyway, Charles Schultz, this is interesting because I feel like his response was a little scripted.
I don't know. Because his response is that he's talking about how remarkable it is that a cartoon lasts for 20 years, 30 years, 40 years. And then he makes a big point of talking about you've got one person sitting down and drawing a new cartoon every single day, day after life-sucking day, while the world passes you by. And it sounds like a suicide note.
Yeah, it's also it is funny because I was also like, well, most of the cartoonists have assistants. I mean, maybe he did it all himself. I don't really know, but
I
like
think he did.
maybe that's a pointed comment to get those other lazy cartoonists who all have like assistants doing the real work.
He's like Bill Watterson saying, maybe some other cartoonists can meet their own personal standards and be on the greens by tea time.
Ouch. Would not want to be Johnny Hart now.
Or
But
Mort Walker or Dick Brown or just about any of them, really.
true. Now, it's funny because the way he says that, he does make, you know, I will say the interviews with cartoonists are actually kind of interesting to get a little bit of insight into their process. And the when Charles Schultz mentions the idea that like, oh yeah, you know, the comic character has to be instantly recognizable and something likable about their appearance, so you want to spend time looking at them, which was kind of an interesting thing to hear, kind of the theory behind, you know, character design in cartoons. But the way he's delivering his line, it feels like they interviewed him and they were like, okay, Charles, say that same thing again. And he was like, okay, I will say the line, because it just sounds very canned and very rehearsed,
Well,
which is
I'm not
weird.
surprised because did you because doesn't it sound a lot to you like his introduction to the first Calvin and Hobbes book?
Oh, yeah, it kind of does actually.
Yeah, where he says, he says, Bill Watterson draws great end tables. I admire that. I love Calvin's shoes that look like dinner rolls and his thin little arms.
Is hilarious.
Because it kind of sounds like he's struggling for to say something he likes about Calvin and Hobbes, but he's not struggling because he really does value those things. He's just a cartoonist, and cartoonists are kind of boring.
Well, it's better than what is it? The who is the other
Oh, Pat Oliphant.
Oh yeah, where he was like where he for some reason a real vendetta against the Cosby kids.
They
I remember
didn't have
him
a comic strip.
I know, but I remember him saying like, you know, Bill Watterson only gets childhood right, not like those wisecracking Cosby kids. And it was like, okay.
Mealy mouths and namby-pambies.
Yeah. I don't know. It was very odd. But you know, Pat Oliphant, he was probably he's a curmudgeon, I guess.
Yeah,
But you know, whatever.
he's a curmudgeon, but then he got, really smarmy there. It's like, you want magic? I give you Calvin and Hobbes. This book is magic.
It's like, all right, buddy. Okay. And then he's like, Reagan sucks.
Oh, we love to hate Pat Oliphant on the show.
Come on, man. We're going to knock that Pat Oliphant down a peg. It's about time someone rubbed his nose in it. He's been having it too good for too long. Right now, Tom Tolles is listening and being like, yeah, that's right.
No, Tom Tolles is doing that in the very corner as a tiny little doodle.
That's right.
I love Tom Tolles, actually.
Yeah. I got nothing against him. He was just the first political cartoonist I could think of.
Well, I mean, it wouldn't make any sense to be like, oh, I don't know, who the dude who drew the Tammany Tiger?
Yeah, oh, Thomas Nast.
Yeah, Thomas Nast. Be like, yeah, fuck you, Oliphant.
Yeah. Oh, actually, the one who would be, it should be, oh, God. I just remembered because the foreword to the Pat Oliphant book was written by I forget his name, but a political comedian who used to play piano.
Not Tom Lehrer, the other one?
The other one, not the funny one.
The one they were satirizing in the Simpsons episode where they go to the Washington, D.C.?
I think so, yeah. Yeah, that one. You know, he's like, his name's like Russ Meyer or something.
Russ Meyer!
Yeah, yeah, and he's all like, you know, because like he's doing the piano. We got a big deficit. We got a great big deficit. We got big, great big heaving deficit. Russ Meyer on piano. But he wrote the foreword.
And Roger Ebert's like, yeah, woo!
There we go. But he wrote the foreword to the Pat Oliphant book. In it, he talks about how much he hates Pat Oliphant because Pat Oliphant is apparently such a good artist. So and so good at satirizing politics. So he would be the one who's all like, yeah, take that, Pat Oliphant.
Well, no, if we're looking for someone who really hates Pat Oliphant, we need to get Burke Brevin.
Oh, that's right. Which is interesting.
Burke Brevin, who, you know, explicitly said there's a tiny little man with a very small penis named Pat Oliphant.
He's also who very explicitly misnomered he gave the wrong name to Punk the Penguin in his comic. He's called him Little Ollie Funt,
which is a much better name.
Yeah, true. That's fair. Anyway, so we get this interview with Charles Schulz, and then we get the animated segment, which is Snoopy doing a little dance and singing about supper time.
Yeah, and I wasn't sure what if this was written for the special or not, but no, it's from a boy named Charlie Brown. Okay.
Okay. All right. So are all of these clips from things or just some of them?
Many of them are new, but some of them are clips from other things. That's a clip from something that existed already. And so is the thing with, so is the Broomhilda sketch. I think so is the Tumbleweeds.
Okay. So they had a new Charlie Brown special premiering that year, and yet they were like, we're not going to show a clip from that. This is a very poor attempt at promoting their movies. It's whatever. Okay. But yeah, it's like Charlie Brown does, Snoopy does a little dance about how great supper time is.
And did you hear... Okay, yeah, he does the supper time bit, and then we go to Mort Walker, and Mort Walker tells the story about belly buttons.
That was interesting.
It was, actually.
So because apparently he was telling the story. He mentions how I learned something about Beetle Bailey. He was saying Beetle Bailey was originally a college student, but then got drafted into the Korean War, and after that it just became a military strip. And apparently that's where it really took off. Probably, I'm assuming, because, after the Korean War, every dude in the country has been drafted. So you see a military strip and it's relatable now. That's an experience you've had. So that's probably, so anyway.
Oh my God, Mike.
Yes.
Go to the, talk to the syndicate. Make a, make up a strip about self-isolating.
Oh shit. That's right. Oh, I'm going to make a million.
And we have it recorded that I gave you the idea, so I get half.
God damn it. But anyway, so this story about belly buttons, Mort Walker starts talking about how apparently he drew, you know, belly buttons on like sexy girls in Beetle Bailey. And the syndicate was like, you can't do that. The readers will get too horny. They'll get too horny for the belly buttons in Beetle Bailey because they're so well drawn. So apparently they had an editor who was dedicated entirely to cutting the belly buttons out of Beetle Bailey.
And he saved them.
Yes, in a little box.
Little box labeled Beetle Bailey Belly Buttons.
Yeah.
Beetle Bailey Belly Buttons. Beetle Bailey Buttons. And finally, Mort drew a cartoon where a truckload of sexy girls arrived and unloaded crate after crate of navel oranges. And that broke him. He never cut the belly buttons out again.
Yeah. So that's actually kind of an amusing story behind the scenes in the syndicate, you know, kind of find out how the sausage is made.
Then we cut to the animated Beetle Bailey sequence. And this is weird because it's a normal Beetle Bailey sequence where Sarge is chasing Beetle, but Sarge says, I'm going to get you, Beetle.
Yeah. So Sarge's voice is completely wrong. Because I kind of remember there was a Beetle Bailey cartoon, and Sarge's voice was always kind of, I mean, how do I describe Sarge's real voice? It's kind of like, Beetle, I'm, you know, kind of like that.
Yeah, yeah.
And this one, you know,
the voice you would give if somebody said, hey, do a tough drill sergeant voice.
Yeah, exactly.
And this is not it.
This, he sounds a little like Garfield.
And I was just, and I was really hoping that the punchline to this was, why have you been chasing Beetle? He gave me Valium.
It is funny because, like, when he catches Beetle and Lieutenant, I think it's Lieutenant Flap.
It's Flap, yeah.
Yeah, which is, sees him. And it's funny because Lieutenant Flap is, he's the black character in Beetle Bailey.
Yes.
And he sees Sarge dragging Beetle. And he's like, hey, man, what's up with that? Like, kind of. It's like, it was 1980, so I mean, maybe they were like, that's how a black person talks. He talks like the Jive guys in Airplane. But
I was gonna say, he sounds like they got Mom's Mabley to do his voice, but
yeah, it's you know, it's a thing. But the punchline is Beetle didn't want to do his obstacle course, so yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Also, did you notice that in this one, Lieutenant Flap appears and he has one line? And also in Popeye Meets the Man Who Hated Laughter, Lieutenant Flap appears and he has one line.
Is Lieutenant Flap the one who was having on a date with General Halftrack in The Man Who Hated Laughter?
Yes.
Okay, that's right. Yeah, yeah. Well, typical, isn't it?
They were just drinking each other in with their eyes. They didn't have time to talk. But then they get out and the general's like, I want to try something, Flap. Can I chase you around the table a few times?
Well, they're valid.
Good.
So after the Beetle Bailey, we get, what's the next comic that they...
It's Dennis the Menace.
Ooh, and of course, Loni Anderson is in some sexy overalls with her pigtails. So...
That specifically 70s horny where they weren't sure what was okay.
Yeah.
But this does not feel okay to me.
Yeah.
It feels dirty.
Yeah, this is really, it's, yeah, but.
It feels dirty, but also badly done. Like when you, it's like a dirty magazine. Remember those, kids? Remember when porn used to come in magazines and it would be called Barely Legal, and there'd be a 34-year-old woman with her hair in pigtails.
Yeah.
Sucking a lollipop.
Wearing one of those little sailor suits.
Twirling a fidget spinner.
Vaping.
With the Instagram dog overlay on her face.
Yeah. Oh, I'm getting a little, get a little hot and bothered over here.
On a TikTok.
Whoa, boy. I don't know if we can put this online anymore.
Having a somebody is over party for somebody in a Korean rock band.
Oh, boy. Oof. Huh. But anyway, she's introducing Dennis the Menace, I believe, right?
Yes.
Yes.
And then Newt Gingrich comes on to talk. Oh, sorry, that's Hank Ketchum.
You know, it's funny because my thought when I saw him was like, oh, it's Father Ted. He is definitely a guy who looks like other people. Hank Ketchum, though, it is interesting because this is not interesting, but I learned something less interesting, that Hank Ketchum is from Carmel, California. And this is only interesting because when my wife was young, her dad often went to Carmel on business trips and brought her, my wife, who was not my wife at the time, and her brother. And, you know, they were children.
Yes.
Real children, not like adults dressed with lollipops. But in Carmel, California, there is a playground called Dennis the Menace Playground, which he always took them to because it had like all these wacky things in it, like a zip line and like an obstacle course and all these things that you would not find in a normal playground. And apparently it was like sponsored and designed by Hank Ketchum. And so finding out that he lived in Carmel, California, kind of explained why he decided that this town needs a really cool playground.
It was in Carmel, because I have been to another one, to another Dennis the Menace park, but that was in Monterey.
Oh, shit. You know what? You're right. You're absolutely right. That was in Monterey. Oh, my God. I should bring my wife in here right now and yell at her for not correcting me when I told her this story earlier. Because I was like, hey, he's from Carmel. That explains why Dennis the Menace Playground is in Carmel. And she was like, that's right. And I was like, you love that playground. You took me to that playground to show me it because you loved it so much as a child. And now it turns out you didn't even love it enough to remind me that it wasn't Carmel. And now I just made a fool of myself in front of all three of our listeners. Dory! Wilma! Blondie!
Nemo!
Yes, Nemo! Get in here! Get in here! I have a bone to pick with you! I guess
while
she's...
Mike is arguing with Mike's wife, get I would in like here. To point out that
Dennis the Menace Playground's not even in Carmel!
And
it's in Monterey!
You should have told me that earlier when I said it was in Carmel.
Are you sure you didn't say Monterey that time, too? And you just forgot?
We're lumping them together.
Oh.
Like you always say, Jennifer lives in L.A., but she lives in Thousand Oaks.
Oh, okay. So I guess Carmel's next to Monterey, so maybe that still explains it.
Yeah, they're like they're like 3 miles apart. Okay, well. It's like Nevada City and Grass Valley. Well, we mix them up all the time.
In that case, I forgive you.
But I was in Monterey. I grew up going to that park.
Yeah, I was just telling you. Okay, love you.
Yeah, but the thing is, whenever my family made a trip to Monterey, we also went to Carmel, so they're linked in my mind.
Okay, all right.
Okay.
I don't even like distinguish them.
Okay, all right.
I think of Carmel as a suburb of Monterey, almost.
Yeah. All right, okay.
So.
All right, love you.
Yes.
Love you. Okay, all right.
I took you to Denver. So,
I know, yeah. That was... Yeah.
So that was what happened when your wife was young.
Yes.
Which she no longer is.
No, she's an old hag now.
Yes.
I kid.
A Broomhilda.
That's right. We'll be talking more about Broomhilda soon in our... Okay, we'll be talking about Broomhilda in the second episode of the Fantastic Funnies.